Recently, at the Union Plaza Hotel, 1,500 former prisoners of war and their families held a remarkable reunion. Most of them had served in the Second World War, and many had not seen one another since V-Day.
What are you doing here?
Barry! It's been Barry. A long time.
My
35
God,
years. I've been working.
As they greeted one another and as they looked back at their photographs and their memories, a couple of them told me how they tried to keep up their spirits and their pants.
2 weeks later, after I lost 30 pounds, I'm holding my pants up. The Jerry interrogator says, put your hands down. I said, I got no belt. He says, don't talk back. Put your hands up. Put my hands on. Pants fell down.
One of the POWs that used to be in my room used to get letters from his wife all the time. And he always used to be very happy when he read the letters. One day I asked him, I said, why are you so happy when you read these letters? He says, every time my wife writes to me, he says, don't worry, dear, I'm still going out with a colonel.
What did he do when he found out you were Jewish?
The only punishment I ever got as a Jew is on work details. Not in a prison camp, but outside. And his guard used to hit me with the rifle. All POWs, you know this. When they hit you, go down. But I was a brave 21 years old, big butt of an egg man from South Philly. So when he hit me, I stood there. He hit me again. And again. So one British guy, I didn't say Limey.
Yeah.
He said, when he hits you, Yank, fall down. So I fell down and they laughed. The Americans are so weak, you know, and they cry. So that's every time he hit me, I just fall down and cry.
At the war's height, 95,000 American prisoners of war were in German camps. 2,000 died there. However, of the 34,000 American POWs who were sent into Japanese prisoner of war camps, 13,000, or nearly half, did not survive. Many perished on the infamous Bataan Death March.
We walked all the way, I mean, walking day and night. No food, no water, or anything, through the march, which was close to 100 miles.
They escaped from the death march, and unfortunately, the only way out of it was swimming towards Kregador. And I swam to Kregador, me and another fellow, overnight. I was captured again a month later when Kregador fell.
So they tied me up in a kneeling position with a basket of rocks on my lap. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw this Japanese officer walking up, and he had a small caliber pistol in his hand. And next thing I can remember of it was it felt like someone doused me with a bucket of cold water, and he shot me in the head twice. One bullet left some residue, but it ricocheted off my hard Irish head. The other coursed around between the skull and the skin and emerged out of my mouth.
Luis, they say in a foxhole, even an atheist becomes a believer. Is that true?
Most of the cadets from the German services used to fly over our camp, and they used to dive at us and make passes at us. There must have been about 10,000 prisoners of war in this camp. One day, the POWs were hollering, blow up, you son of... And whether it's ESP or whether it's God speaking to us, those four planes went up very high, came straight down and landed outside the camp, and each one of them did blow up right near our camp.
They told me what they missed the most were their wives, hamburgers, and toilet paper. It was something else the men missed even more.
Several of my men came running up to me and said, do you know it's been 3.5 years since we saw an American flag?
So that night, eight POWs, using torn sheets, shirts, parachutes, and thread from their trousers, stitched together their own stars and stripes.
We didn't have a Betsy Ross there with us. This flag has never been cleaned or dry cleaned. It's just like it was.
The stars and stripes didn't finally fly over all German and Japanese prisoner of war camps until 1945.
I have no ill will against the Japanese, and when you get one of their combat soldiers off by himself, the first thing he would do is show you the pictures of his wife and kids.
I don't feel bitter against them, because let's face it, they had nothing when I had America when I came back.
When they came back to America, though, the war wasn't over for most of these POWs.
Wake up in a sweat every once in a while. I mean, you still relieve those times that we passed over there.
Even to this day, if I go to wake him up in the middle of the night, he wakes up fighting.
I lost quite a bit of hearing. And I also had trouble with blood circulation in my head thereafter.
I have an implanted pacemaker. It's right here. This is my seventh one.
I suffer mostly due to my brain operation. I also suffer because my family suffers.
I had x-rays at the VA, and they told me I had a spot on the lungs and that it would be emphysema.
The men I talked to had suffered malnutrition, beatings, and forced slave labor in coal mines. This mistreatment led to serious physical and emotional problems in civilian life. However, they received little or no help from their own government because the government saw none of their ailments as war-related.
We have not been forgotten. We have been ignored, period. I mean, you know, for myself, I'm speaking for myself. I don't get a damn dime from them.
I didn't get paid for the 86 days I escaped because I wasn't incarcerated. How's that grab you?
Does the government compensate you for this?
No, I paid for five of them, and the last two, the Blue Cross paid for it.
Well, I had to be back to this company. I had difficulty, all right, because they wouldn't recognize my loss of hearing from this.
So I had the x-rays again, and he told me I didn't have any spot on my lungs anymore.
That's how the government cured you?
The minute I told them I was going to put in the claim, my lungs are miraculously healed.
According to the VA.
I had problems with the government since 1946 when I filed my first claim.
We're a minority. POWs come back with one arm, one eye. They're so glad to be back. They don't want nothing, Uncle Sam. Go to the VA, stand there for 5 hours, lose a day's pay. They did it themselves. But now that they're hitting 50, or when they hit 40, and they made their life's living and send their kids to college, they get sick, use their own money. I bet you half of these guys are broke for medical bills. All the POWs want, a little piece of America. What they did, that's all.
Because of the difficulties the POWs have encountered with their own government, I asked them if the government called on them to fight again, would they go?
I'd go today.
Sure as I would.
You bet you.
You bet.
Yes. You bet we would.
Oh, yes.
Yes, I would. If I was able, I'd do anything I could.
I did. I went to Vietnam as a civilian. I'm a disabled veteran, but I went to Vietnam.
The convention ended with the POWs paying tribute to the spirit of their fallen friends. Later, they tried to lift their own spirits attending a production of Stalag 17. We started this story saying Las Vegas seemed an unlikely place for such a gathering, but perhaps it wasn't. These men had gambled everything on America. They put their lives on the line for. And even though the government may not have yet fully paid its debt, these men still consider themselves winners because they live in such a land.
Precious. Congratulations.